The first moon flying at Thornaby took place in 1912 from Vale Farm, with a flying display sponsored by the Daily Mail newspaper. During World War I, Vale Farm was a 34-acre Class 2 landing ground, which was probably used by No. 36 Squadron, but with the end of the war, the airfield was quickly abandoned. In 1928, the Air Ministry purchased an area of land between the River Tees and a wood-lined beck next to Thornaby on Tees, encompassing Thornaby Hall, Thornaby Grange, Thornaby Lodge and Vale Farm, to convert the area into a grass-surfaced airfield. 2 years later, in 1930, RAF Thornaby opened in No. 1 Air Defence Group, and on the 17th of March, No. 608 Auxiliary Air Force Squadron formed there, equipped with Westland Wapiti Day Bomber aircraft. RAF Thornaby was assigned the Pundit code of TB. No. 608 Squadron remained the sole occupant until the 2nd of March 1936, when No. 9 Flying Training School formed at Thornaby under the control of No. 23 Group, equipped with Harts, Audaxes and Hinds. In the January of 1937, No. 608 Squadron became a fighter squadron and swapped their Wapiti bombers for Hawker Demon fighters. Other changes were also taking place. No. 9 FTS moved to RAF Hullavan on the 8th of July to make way for No. 224 Squadron from RAF Boscombe Down and No. 233 Squadron from Tangmere, both equipped with Avro Anson's. The tenure at Thornaby was to be brief, and on the 17th of January 1938, No. 224 Squadron moved to Eastleigh, followed by No. 233 Squadron, which moved to Lucas on the 1st of September. They were replaced by Numbers 106 and 185 Squadrons, arriving from Abingdon with ferry battles. But again, they were only to be a short stay resident, for on the 25th of September, No. 185 Squadron moved to RAF Cottesmere, followed by No. 106 Squadron to Grantham. The sole resident squadron, No. 608, changed roles once more to become a General Reconnaissance Squadron on the 20th of March 1939, and converted to Anson's to fly anti-submarine patrols. This type of work usually involved long, boring flights over the sea with little or no result. In September, Thornaby was transferred to Coastal Command with No. 608 Squadron under the command of No. 18 Group. And during October, No. 608 Squadron received bothers, but they were found unsuitable, and so the squadron reverted to their ensigns. A new resident at Thornaby, No. 1509 Blind Approach Training Flight, formed in No. 16 Group Coastal Command, with Wellingtons on the 15th of December 1940, just in time to observe Thornaby undergo a transformation and expansion, which included the laying of three concrete runways, a perimeter track with 33 hearth standings, and permanent buildings to the northeast of the airfield. It was furnished with three blister and one Bellman hangars, plus two aeroplane sheds and a control tower of a unique type. They were joined on the 2nd of March by No. 114 Squadron, which arrived briefly from RAF Alton with Blenheim Falls. At the same time, No. 608 Squadron began converting to the Blenheim. On the 13th of May, No. 114 Squadron moved to RAF Lucas, and in July, No. 1509 BAT moved to RAF Dice, leaving No. 608 Squadron as the sole occupant once more. And now, it began to convert to Hudson 3s, 5s and 6s. They were joined in July by another short-stay resident, No. 143 Squadron, which arrived from Aldergrove with Bowfighter 1s on the 4th and departed on the 19th for RAF Dice. No. 6 Coastal Operational Training Unit reformed at Thornaby on the 19th of July in No. 17 Coastal Command Group, with an establishment of Hudson, Anson and Oxford aircraft. To accommodate the need for training flights, No. 17 OTU acquired nearby RAF West Hartlepool as a satellite on the 8th of September. In January 1942, No. 608 Squadron was finally moved from their long-term home at Thornaby, arriving at RAF Wick on the 2nd of January, leaving Thornaby solely for use by No. 17 OTU. From April to June, a detachment of No. 332 Norwegian Squadron, which was based at North Weald, arrived with Spitfires to operate out of Thornaby. A need for night flying facilities for the OTU led to RAF Longtown in Cumbria being acquired for night flying from the 7th of July. By September, No. 17 OTU ceased Hudson training and began to re-equip with Wellingtons, and on the 27th of October it absorbed a Polish training flight from No. 18 OTU. On the 8th of November, number 17 OTU was joined by number 1429 Czech Operation Training Flight, which arrived from RAF Church Brougham. However, this was absorbed into number 17 OTU as the Czech flight on the 27th of February 1943. 1943 brought two more Spitfire detachments to Thornaby. The first, number 401 Squadron, arrived from RAF Catterick in January and departed in May when the squadron moved south to RAF Redhill. It was replaced by number 306 Polish Squadron Detachment when that unit arrived from RAF Catterick on the 30th of May and stayed until the squadron departed for RAF Gravesend on the 11th of August. Number 17 OTU's tenure at Thornaby ended on the 10th of March when they exchanged with number 1 OTU at RAF Siloth. Number 1 OTU immediately commenced training coastal command crews on Hudsons, Boeing B-17 Fortresses and Consolidated Liberators. On the 24th of the month, the Liberator conversion flight was detached at Bewley, and from July, number 1 OTU began training crews on the Handley Page Halifax. A revision of Coastal Command's training requirements led to the training being transferred to No. 5 OTU on the 16th of October, and the disbandment of No. 1 OTU on the 19th. The Fortress and Liberator training was transferred to 1674 flight at RAF Longtown. Throughout the war, there had been a growing need for an effective air-sea rescue network. RAF Thornaby was now given over to an air-sea rescue role. The following day, the 20th, the Air Sea Rescue Training Unit arrived from RAF Bertram Newton, and No. 280 ASR Squadron arrived from RAF Thorny Island, both with Warwick 1s. They were joined on the 22nd of November when No. 281 ASR Squadron reformed, also with Warwicks. 1944 saw further movement and brief stays at Thornaby. On the 27th of February, No. 281 Squadron moved to RAF Tyree. On the 1st of May, No. 280 Squadron moved to RAF Strubby. And on the 2nd of June, the Air Sea Rescue Training Unit disbanded into No. 5 OTU at RAF Turnberry to leave Thornaby quiet apart from a detachment of No. 280 Squadron. However, a new unit, No. 279 ASR Squadron, arrived from RAF Bertram Newton with Hudsons on the 31st of October and immediately began to re-equip with Warwicks. This was to become the resident squadron until the end of hostilities, continuing Air Sea Rescue coverage of the North Sea. In 1945, there was a flurry of activity when No. 455 Royal Australian Air Force Squadron of the former Dalaki Strike Wing arrived in early May with bow fighters and flew a number of anti-shipping strikes in the Kiel area to counter any attempt by Nazi diehards to flee to Norway and continue the war. At the end of the month, they were disbanded. On the 3rd of September, No. 279 Squadron moved to RAF Beccles and was replaced by No. 280 Squadron from RAF Langham on the 23rd of November. No. 608 Squadron Royal Auxiliary Air Force reformed at Thornaby on the 10th of May 1946, but did not receive aircraft. On the 21st of June, No. 280 Squadron disbanded. Mosquito Mark 30 night fighters arrived for No. 608 Squadron in July 1947, and later Spitfires and Vampires. No. 275 Squadron arrived from RAF Linton-on-Ouse on the 18th of November 1954 with Sycamore helicopters for search and rescue duties. The long-term resident No. 608 Squadron finally disbanded on the 10th of March 1957, leaving Thornaby the sole preserve of No. 275 Squadron. However, Thornaby was not quite finished, for on the 30th of September, No. 92 Squadron arrived from RAF George with Hunter aircraft. To make room for the jets, No. 275 Squadron moved to RAF Leckenfield on the 9th of October. On the 1st of October 1958, No. 92 Squadron returned to RAF Middleton St. George, and Thornaby was closed. Apart from use by a local air training corps squadron, the airfield was rapidly disposed of and converted into housing. It is hard now to believe that an airfield ever existed there.